welcome to this week's episode of Real. I'm your host, Kalani Fisher. This week, we're looking at the theme of belonging. So, what does it mean to belong, and why do people need to feel like they belong? Now, some people will pay anything for a sense of belonging. Apparently, the world's most expensive club is Resident Superior. Its Black Card membership costs $280,000 annually. Clearly, belonging goes hand in hand with exclusion, which leads into our first short film, Spilt Milk. Let's take a look.
This mixture is much too dry. Damn.
Alright, now I'm off.
Are you going to have some breakfast?
No time. I've got to meet Lisa at the pizza shop at 10 a.m, so I better run.
Fine. Then just make sure you eat something. You need your calcium.
Hey, where do you think you're going?
Just out.
You know it's the first Saturday of the month and your board's due? Well, I expect $50 on my table this afternoon, okay, Barry? No more excuses.
All right, it will be, I understand. See ya.
He's sour. The fling you two had, it's past its expiration date. It's Pizza Box's turn now.
Love, this is how it starts. I wake up alone, always checking my phone. There's a lot of things I don't understand, a lot of things that I try. There's many ways to kill a man, and one is in your eyes. So take a seat, I'll tell you about life. It repeats and cuts like a knife. I thought I knew what love was before I met you. You're changing all the rules. All my love won't do.
Babe I was with today?
Yeah, mate, she was a bit of alright.
Anything off that? Nah, some milk carton dude came and ruined everything. Absolute prick.
Let's go sort him out then, eh?
Is that him over there? Sure is.
Whoa, look.
Barry, are you all right?
Yeah, I'm okay.
I'm so sorry. This should have happened. It's all my fault.
There's no use crying over spilt milk.
I really like that giant milk costume. That was Spilt Milk by Brad Guy. Now, it is said that a sense of belonging to a harmonious community makes most people feel healthier, happier, and safer. Well, after the break, we'll look at one such community in Fitzroy. Don't go away. Welcome back. Now, recently a bunch of La Trobe students went to the Melbourne suburb of Fitzroy to find out why it is one of the most beloved communities in the inner city. This is what they found out.
What do I love about Fitzroy?
What do I love about Fitzroy?
What do I like about Fitzroy?
Yeah, what do you love about Fitzroy?
What do I love about Fitzroy is, I would say, the diversity in terms of architecture, restaurants, cafes, people, yeah.
The pubs, just the ability to be able to walk out of your office and wander straight into a bar that's serving, as good a beer as you could hope to have in your hand.
The vibe is just fantastic. It's no better place, really. Love it.
Mm. It's a shithole. And all the people are shit.
Well, I like the street. I like the liveliness of it. I like all the different little shops that are intermixed.
I went to a place called St Kilda first, and it's full of bogans and meatheads.
What do I love about Fitzroy? It's all here. Like, to live, work in Fitzroy, it's... Really, I wouldn't be anywhere else.
Now, I found out earlier this week that Fitzroy is Melbourne's smallest suburb in terms of area at approximately 100 hectares. But on top of that, in the 2006 census, it had a population of 8,814, with 43.7% of its residents born overseas. Now, that's a fantastic multicultural community. No wonder so many people love belonging to it. Now, the next documentary is packed with tattoos, punk, pushing people over at high speeds, all the while balancing on 8 wheels. Welcome to the contact sport of roller derby. But there's a little bit more about this sport. Let's take a look at Matt Horn's documentary, Derby Wives.
Okay, a derby wife is pretty much the one other person in a roller derby league that's really got your back.
They're a, sort of a confidant, a person you can talk to.
They're the one that will ride in the ambulance with you if you break your leg.
A derby wife is pretty much just a buddy on the team, and you look out for them and they look out for you.
It's all about the friendship and
the reliance on the other person.
It's just an easy way to say it, really.
Yeah. I mean, it really is just someone that you've, like, you know, you meet, you want, you like, you hang out with, you talk to, you find that you can be really open with this person pretty much straight away.
Someone who you think you will listen to if you screw up, and someone that you think will listen to you if they screw up.
If you don't need to have a derby wife, you can do it yourself. There's plenty of people I know that don't have derby wives, but derby's a really tough sport emotionally and personally, and it can take a lot out of you. And if you don't have someone there to talk to, then, you know, you can get a bit lost in it sometimes.
You know how your derby wife skates. She knows how you skate. You have a lot of eye contact as well. You don't necessarily have to communicate to each other verbally what you're going to do. I think there's a bit of Jedi powers going on there with the derby wives. A team of derby wives will smash any other team.
comes to Tina and Squealer, those guys are kind of the cute couple. They're kind of quirky and funny.
Squeals is a little bit protective off the track. I kind of try and look after her on the track, but off the track, she's definitely in charge. She's definitely the Xena of the relationship off the track.
This one time I stood up for Brooke, she was getting attacked by another one of the Derby girls, and I yelled at her over the bent, and I'm like, get off my wife! I did. But really loud. It stopped the room.
Because Tina teases Squealer a lot, and Squealer squeals a lot, and she says really funny things.
I once heard her describe a bug on the floor of one of our training sessions as, is that a little baby mouse? She's also made the statement in a car that she loves the smell of bush.
And then Tina teases Squealer for the funny things that she says, and then Squealer doesn't realise it's funny, and that is gold. Watching that is gold.
When she's at training, you know that you're going to laugh either at her or with her. She's either going to scream because the hockey boys have accidentally thrown a puck into the wall, or she's going to fall over and somehow cause a 9-person pile up, or she's going to say something that, you know, will absolutely kill you and you'll be laughing for, you know, weeks afterwards.
With Rena and Bliss, there was a bit of confusion in the early days because there was a third party in the relationship.
I don't know, I didn't have a wife for ages because Rena picked someone else to start with. The first wife, I was actually sort of, like, secretly, we were sort of together as well, me and Jackie behind Rena's back.
I think Rena and Bliss have really found their feet, and they have a genuine warmth to their relationship. They really do look after each other. They just look at each other sometimes and you know they've got it going on.
Nah, she's shit. Shit.
Oh, I love you.
You're a dog.
Yeah, I am a dog.
The Derby wife thing, it's outside of Derby, it's inside of Derby.
We usually do mainly talk about Derby. We touch on our private lives too, but it's mainly Derby.
I think it depends what you want out of the wife relationship. Like, if you want the confident, the support, the trust, you just have like a single Derby wife relationship and that's it.
You know what? Tina Sparkhill has a mistress. I don't have one, but I'm open, you know. If she wants to do whatever she wants to do, then that's fine.
My Derby mistress is Hot Lips Rangahan from Latrobe City Roller Derby. And we met at a roller camp earlier this year and just were a little bit kindred and decided that, you know, rather than take another wife, you know, we could just have a little bit on the side. It doesn't have quite the impact that your Derby wife does, you know. I'm not going to run away and clear out the bank account and leave Squeals, you know. It's just a little bit of fun with someone from another league who you really love skating with.
Yeah, definitely got a ticket if I want to have another interleague mistress.
I've witnessed a fake ring. I've seen bunches of flowers. One of the girls in our league did get very nervous about proposing to her wife and was just like, what if she says no? And, well, she won't say no. She'll be fine. She loves you. That's always fun to be part of the, you know, the wife vibe. Ask her. You know, it's fun.
Like, I know some of the girls have just been skating around the track and go, hey, you want to be my wife? Yeah, sure, why not? Like, it's a pretty casual thing, but I think most of the time you know that it's coming and it's just like someone's got to ask first and it happens. It's pretty casual.
Yeah, it is.
One day kind of everyone was talking about Derby wives and turned to each other and went, you know, all right, maybe you and I should do this because this could be fun. And that's how we ended up as Derby wives. And we have been ever since.
The Derby wife relationship is absolutely about friendship and support and has nothing to do with sexual relationships or anything intimate that ever happens.
We joke about that stuff, but yeah, definitely, yeah, your Derby wife isn't, you know, the sexual partner. She's your best friend.
And your actual wife in life, for those who are lady lovers out there, your lady lover can't be your real derby wife. That's just not right.
Like I said, it's the comfort that you get from having someone close to you in derby. I always feel a lot better when Kirby's at training. If she's not there, you know, I'm always like, oh, she's not here. Oh, well, carry on.
I've found derby really tough, and it's been really tough on me too in the beginning. And I think without support of, you know, squeals, I may not have got through certain times. Just words of encouragement and her positive attitude, you know, they make me want to, you know, skate better and be just as good as her.
Most of us don't know each other before we start skating. You know, you just don't know anyone. And then all of a sudden you're in this really intense, non-sexual, accountable relationship. And I reckon that's bizarre. I don't know, what other sport does that?
Now, I've got a bit of a confession to make. I actually really like contact sports. I don't get a chance to do them enough. But when I watch that documentary, I feel like taking someone out. I obviously won't, but yeah, it's an incredible documentary. So well done to the filmmakers that made that. Now, once again, we're joined by our regular guest, Dr. Gabriel Murray from La Trobe University Media and Cinema Studies Program. Gabriel, thank you for joining us again.
Thank you, Kalani, and I'm slightly nervous after that last comment, being the closest person to you.
I probably won't do anything to you, but if I watch that again, I might get a bit fired up.
You just never know. I think I'm a bit fired up too, though.
Oh,
so.
Good. All right, now, my first question that I have for you tonight, Derby Wives, it touches on the importance of friendship. How do you think this is so?
And now I'm going to do a terrible thing, which is what I often do.
Yes,
and I'm just going to have to say, I was watching the start of your fantastic earlier sequence,
yeah.
And Residence Superior. Do you know anyone who is a member?
I actually don't. And it must be that exclusive that I actually didn't know about Residence Superior until before this show.
I have to confess, I didn't either. And I have a terrible feeling that if I go on Google, I'm not going to find it.
No, you probably won't.
But we can only kind of imagine what services are provided for $280,000 a year.
I think each person would probably have four butlers each or something like that. Something crazy.
It's a nice way of thinking about it, I would say. And I'm going to ask you to repeat your question again, as usual.
Derby Wives, it touches on the importance of friendship. How do you think this is so?
The thing I find absolutely fascinating about this film is, number one, it makes me want to be a derby wife. There's no question about it. And I feel like I've missed out terribly. When I think about roller derby, I think, oh, yeah, there's been films about it. And I think we were talking before about, in the breaks, about, you know, the fact that, you know, it's a big sport in America, etc. But
yes.
I really didn't know anything about, you know, that it was a sport here and it was a contact sport and it's played with such sort of vigour and energy and kind of dedication. So I knew nothing about these kinds of relationships that evolve.
I didn't either, actually. Keep going.
No, after you.
But that's what I love about documentaries. They teach you so many things. They really are a learning aid. And you just kind of, because it's factual, you find out so many different things that you probably wouldn't usually find out or didn't even know about.
I was just going to say, there's such, there's diversity of characters kind of within this film. So, and, you know, we sort of in previous programs have talked about identity, and it's like, you know, this particular sport has got these women who take on these particular roles, and they only happen within the roller world, you know.
Yeah.
They're not roles that are really carried outside that. So I sort of found that whole investigation into those relationships really, really interesting.
It was so interesting.
I want a name, you know. I was trying to remember some of the names.
Were so
Tina
cool.
Sparkle.
And Disson Ballerina.
Disson Ballerina's got to be the best.
Blister, Bliss Star.
Yeah, yeah.
I reckon that's the coolest part of about the game.
It's the nose.
It actually made me wonder, what would my name be if I was to play this game? And how long would it take me to find the perfect name?
I think it might take you a while.
Well, I mean, my name's Killalani, so it could be Killer something.
Killalani.
Yeah.
There you go. It's an easy one.
Now, Gabriel, in terms of the cinematography of this documentary, what did you think?
I guess the cinematography is not something I picked up on so much as the editing. I think this is a beautifully put together piece of work that kind of segues between the interviews with either the individual wives or the two girls together and the actual action of the roller derby itself. So you actually see them practicing and going through the moves and stuff like that.
Yeah. When you watched this documentary, the first time you watched it, so aside from all the things that you found out, the new things about the roller derby world, what effect did it have on you?
Look, the thing about this particular film is that there's a vibrancy about it. It's like you want to go out and kill people afterwards. You do. You want to have, you know, you want to become involved in contact sport. And so there's a contagion to it. So I think that's fantastic. Yeah. And it's sort of interesting to think about how that happens in the filmmaking process. And I do think it's partly about the way it's put together, but it's also the way it focuses on the particular elements of the names, the kind of music that's playing.
Yes.
You know, the kind of ways in which they talk about their relationships, etc., and then that you actually see them doing the moves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, one last quick question before we wrap it up. Who was your favourite person in that documentary?
I think probably Black Diamond.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like
the
look.
She was great.
I really like the look.
She was really cool.
Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, Gabriel, once again.
Sort of habitual once again. Yes. Thank you, Kalani.
And, we really look forward to seeing you next week. Beautiful. Well, that's all we've got time for tonight, unfortunately. We would love to stretch this show on for longer, especially with all the cool documentaries that we've seen so far. But I do look forward to seeing you next week when we explore the theme of isolation. I'm your host, Killalani Fisher. Keep it real, Melbourne.